Retro.
No.
Hello there. This is James Arnold Taylor, the voice of Obi-Wan Kenobi, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continuously unexpected. So uncivilized.
This is podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Welcome to Podcast Stardust. This is the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. We are your hosts. I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And on this episode, we'll be discussing episode 4 of season 3 of Rebels, the Antilles extraction. But Jay, can you remind everybody where we can be found around the internet?
Absolutely, Dennis. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
Okay, the dish is aligned. The signal is boosted to maximum output. The shield is down, and we are now broadcasting to the galaxy. This is our discussion of Antilles extraction. So this is a spoiler-filled discussion. If you haven't got to this episode yet, you might want to put this aside and come back. With that warning out of the way, Jay, if you'll go ahead and give us our summary of the episode, please.
Sure, and if you weren't a Star Wars fan, you would probably think you were going to the dentist with this one. Mm-hmm. We need Ryder Waldron here. So here we go. Phoenix Squadron has suffered numerous losses to its ranks of pilots. After receiving a message from Fulcrum that there are cadets at Skystrike Academy that are ready to defect from the Empire, Hera sends Sabine undercover to extract the pilots, with Ezra and Kanan serving as her handlers in a rebel transport. Once at the academy, Sabine meets Wedge, Hobby, and Rake, who are the cadets willing to defect. Their attempt to defect is complicated when Agent Callis and Governor Pryce arrive. During a training exercise, they make their move, but Pryce disables their ships. Rake is shot down, and the rebellion's transport is forced to retreat. Afterwards, Pryce begins to interrogate Sabine, Wedge, and Hobby. Sabine resists, and the three begin another escape attempt. Just when the stormtroopers are closing in, Agent Callis unexpectedly shows up and tells them how to escape in a TIE bomber. Soon thereafter, Ezra and Kanan arrive to rescue Sabine and company from a pursuing TIE interceptor.
Yeah, so this is a fun episode after getting a lot of stuff that was focused on Kanan and Ezra in the first three episodes of the season. We now get to give attention elsewhere. And so Sabine is up in this one with the infiltration of the academy. What did you think about this one overall?
I liked it in the fact that it was cool to see Sabine undercover and seeing her with her dark hair, but also seeing how cool and collected that she was in being able to just go right back into that Imperial sort of demeanor from being at the academy, and also tying those threads together to A New Hope, you know, and getting some Wedge and Hobby, who we also see in The Empire Strikes Back. So I just thought it was really cool. And then the whole Fulcrum thing. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so good episode.
Yeah, there's some fun discussion points to get into here. Real quick, I'll point out that this episode was written by Gary Whitta, who also wrote Rogue One. And in fact, the alias that Sabine used while she was in the Academy, Rhea Tala, is a leftover name from early Rogue One's production. So that was pretty cool. I of course love Rogue One. I know you do too. We've been doing an mm-hmm. entire series about it this year. And Gary Whitta, when he writes Star Wars, does a pretty good job, and he did a number of Rebels things. So it's fun to see him get another episode here. The number of debuts for Rebels as well, including the first appearance of the TIE Interceptor and the classic Rebel transport. Of course, the one that the Rebels used to escape from Hoth in mm-hmm. this episode. So it's neat to see them come up with more models that they could incorporate into the show. That had kind of been one of the criticisms of Rebels through seasons 1 and 2, is that if you've seen one Imperial officer, you've seen them all. They have the same like six people that show up in every city, the Ithorian, the guy with the vest, and and they had a limited number of assets, so they had to keep reusing things. So whenever they got to incorporate something new, it was special. Besides the fact that it's like, oh, this is the first time that they used TIE interceptors or X-Wings or whatever here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. So there's a lot of great trivia that's involved in this one.
Right. And another bit of that trivia was that this originally was going to be a Biggs Darklighter story. And they ultimately ended up not going that route simply because of canon timeline restrictions that would put Biggs elsewhere at the time that this episode took place. And they couldn't figure out a way to work around that. But if you go to the episode guide and you watch Rebels Recon, there is this discussion with Pablo Hidalgo talking about how Sabine had that checkerboard pattern on one of her pauldrons in her armor in the first season of Rebels. And of course, Biggs had that checkerboard pattern on his helmet that we saw in A New Hope. So they were trying to figure out a way to make that work so that Sabine could paint that helmet for Biggs, which would have been a fun, nice touch. It's too bad they couldn't get to work out.
Oh, I agree, because that's one of those things that I love about how they tie all the continuity to Star Wars together. So yeah, it would have been fun, but I mean, I understand they just didn't think they had enough to go with for that.
Right. So you brought up the whole notion of this fulcrum, and we know that previously Ahsoka had served in that role when she was an operative for the Rebellion and doing some recruitment. And we get a communication from a Fulcrum officer here after the Rebels have just suffered a defeat at the hand of the Empire and their TIE interceptors when they shot down 6 pilots. And so now they got to find some more, and Fulcrum contacts them and lets them know that there's these cadets at the Skystrike Academy that are looking to get out, looking to defect, and they should go get them. And this was a new concept in a way for Star Wars fans, because like I said, we all associated Fulcrum with Ahsoka. And when that hologram even shows up, it's Ahsoka's markings.
Mm-hmm.
And Ezra gets excited. It's like, oh, right. Ahsoka? So they kind of psyched us all out there. And of course, we know Cassian Andor is another one of the Fulcrum agents. And what further kind of was disappointing to some fans was that Chuck Wendig's Aftermath novel had come out previous to this. And Wedge was remembering when he was recruited by Fulcrum, and everyone had assumed at the time that, oh, he got recruited by Ahsoka. Well, turns out not so much.
Right, exactly. And I do appreciate the idea that this legacy of Fulcrum lives on, and that it is a title, and it's an honorable one at that for those that work that, as the title suggests, the Fulcrum point between the Rebel Alliance and the Empire to, you know, make things happen. And I do love the fact that they are using Ahsoka's markings as the symbol for Fulcrum as well. So at this point, we don't know who Fulcrum is, but of course we know who it is. But yes. It was very fun to speculate at the time who this voice might actually be.
Well, and they've made a big deal always modulating Fulcrum's voice, whether it was Ahsoka in season 1 or the current character that's doing it now. Right. And frankly, I think it's a bit obvious, but we won't get into that so that we don't spoil future episodes for people who haven't seen it yet.
Exactly.
But at any rate, yeah, there was a lot of speculation as to what was going on there at the time. So Hera picks Sabine for this role, and that's over Ezra's objection, because Ezra is kind of the field leader. That's the way Taylor Gray described him on the Rebels Recon. Now that Kanan's lost his sight, Ezra is almost the most lethal with the lightsaber, since he's a Jedi in training, but still a Jedi there. And so he wants to infiltrate and play the role of the cadet. But Hera's response is like, well, Sabine actually was in an Imperial Academy, and besides that, you're too well known. And plus the fact, I'm glad it was a Sabine-centric episode. You know, you pointed out, you know, she dyes her hair black, and we've had the Ezra undercover story before. I liked seeing Sabine in that role instead.
Oh, I agree. And boy, does she ever kick butt in this, too.
Yeah. I thought it was funny when she shows up on Skystrike, and they are checking everyone's ID cards, which... now I wonder if this had come out after The Mandalorian, if that would have had been chain codes, if that's what they would have called
them. Mind. Yep.
But hers doesn't work at first, and so she blows on the end of it, and sticks it back into it. That's like the old Atari and Nintendo cartridges. Like if it would work at first, you'd blow on that, get all the dust or whatever that might be on the connectors off, and then you put it back in and it worked. Do you think that's what they were going for? Or was it, really just this is something that the Rebellion cooked up for her as a fake? And I think it probably a little bit of both.
Yeah, I cannot help but to think that that was thrown in there just as, kind of an homage to those of us that understand the reference. But yeah, I can see where it would be a little bit of both.
Mm-hmm. What did you think about the simulator scene? So you had Sabine and Wedge working as, pilot and wingman in this exercise. Now, when it started, we as the audience didn't realize it was a simulator. But they're in TIE fighters for the simulation, and they go up against some Y-wings, and then there is this disabled Rebel transport, and they're ordered to fire on it. And both Sabine and Wedge resist firing on it, and then a simulation of the ghost shows up and shoots them both down. I get it from the story perspective that this is necessary because these two connect over the fact that they didn't, Sabine undercover and Wedge in reality didn't join the Empire to shoot down the helpless. They were joining the Empire to defend the galaxy and the like. And so this goes against what they believe in, but at the same time, it was a simulation. And if Sabine was supposed to be undercover, it was only a simulation. Why didn't she just shoot the transport?
That's a good question. Honestly, I hadn't thought about it from that aspect. I guess my focus was on the idea that when Wedge and Sabine introduced each other to, themselves, that they chimed in and said, no names, just numbers. So it was basically the Empire trying to keep things anonymous in a lot of ways, and that they did not want to foster any kind of relationship whatsoever beyond just the numbers. And my first inclination after I figured out that it was the simulation was, oh, this is like the Kobayashi Maru, which I knew you would appreciate that from Star Trek. But yeah, I mean, that's a really good point about why didn't she just blow it up and try to prove that she was part of the Empire. But maybe she did that too to see who the defectors were, because if she knew that there was some sympathy there for this Rebel transport, that maybe that was her clue.
Yeah, I mean, she covered for it well when they got out of the simulator by questioning, what was that ship? That's not a Rebel ship. And she was referring to the Ghost, which was a smart move because she acted like she didn't recognize it, as opposed to, I recognize that ship. Oh, really? How do you recognize that ship? And so that helped her out, but still, at the same time, I get it. The plot has to move. And this was a convenient way of helping her identify someone who had the same Rebel sympathies. And because right after this, Wedge and Sabine meet up and, they kind of talk this all out. This is why they didn't join. This is not why they joined the Empire, and they have sympathies that lie elsewhere. And so Sabine says, hey, we got your message and I'm going to get you out of here. That's what I'm here to do. And so it all works out and that's fine. But to me, it's just kind of, if I'm undercover and there's no real consequences to me blowing up a simulated ship, I'm going to blow up the simulated ship.
I'm going to do it. Yeah.
Yeah. So it seemed like the safer way to go. But then we've got, Callus and Pryce here, and they've they launched this investigation. They've been challenging them on this whole thing. And so now we get this real live action dogfight where their lasers have been powered down so they can still shoot at each other, but it won't do any real damage. And this is where Sabine, Wedge, Hobby, and Rake, a new character, are going to make their move. And we get our Kenner TIE Fighter callback, because just as they're about to get away, Pryce presses a button and all their solar rays fall off, just like the old toys. I loved seeing that they went that route. I mean, I know a lot of this look was actually inspired by some of the action figures, and that's how they decided to go forth the show. But just taking that extra step with the TIE Fighters was brilliant.
That's awesome that you caught that, because I saw that here in the notes and I thought, oh my gosh, that's so brilliant. I did not make that connection, but that's super cool.
Yeah. And then, of course, they gave us this new character, Rake, as the sacrifice. It could be anyone that we obviously heard, I had ever heard of, obviously, but, Rake, we hardly knew you. So there he goes. And of course, they don't get away. Ezra didn't want to abandon them. Kanan said, you know, we're no good to her dead, so we got to get out of here. And this leads to the interrogation scene. And it was almost adorable that Wedge was so inexperienced with this type of a thing that he immediately gives away Sabine's name.
Yeah.
And, I know he was young in A New Hope, and he's got considerably more experience by the time we get to Return of the Jedi, but he is extremely raw and green in this episode.
Mm-hmm. And naive and the whole nine yards. And but I also think that it shows just how genuine and wholesome he is too, that he just doesn't, you know, have that kind of bone in his body. But that whole face off between Pryce and Sabine there was awesome. I love that girl fight and how she took Pryce down in that fight. And she said to her, Pryce said to her, "The Empire has trained me well." And then Sabine says, "But my clan has trained me better." That mm-hmm. was so great.
Yeah. Cause, Pryce had pulled up the wanted file for mm-hmm. Sabine and noted that she was a little Mandalorian. She's being condescending about it. And so Sabine is able to throw that back in her face. I also kind of liked it that they looked similar with the way that Sabine had dyed her hair. And so it was just kind of a symmetry there in the opponents. And Sabine was able to come out on top and then throw her into the torture device. And so Pryce gets that funny look on her face as she gets shot.
Yeah.
Falls to the floor. And then meanwhile, Wedge and Hobby are trying to figure out how they're going to bust out and rescue Sabine. And then she shows up at the door. Hey, boys.
We were about to rescue you. Oh, that's cute. Yeah. Let's go.
That was a good line.
Sabine's great. That's cute. Appropriate. Let's go.
And then Callus is the one there that shows up and, you know, they're blasting stormtroopers as they're closing in. And then Callus shows up and is like, "Don't shoot." And then he tells them which floors to go to and where they'll find a ship waiting for them. And Sabine does not trust this one bit until Callus says, "Tell Garazeb Aurelius that we're even."
Yeah.
And
so great.
Sabine never gets a chance to ask Zeb about that in this episode. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I think that would have been something foremost on my mind when I got back to Chopper Base.
Definitely. Definitely. Yes, because that's kind of, especially to use his full name and just the way that he said it too, was a very knowing type of a tone of voice, not just in a panicked way or in a condescending "I told you so" kind of a way.
Right. If this had been the Agent Callus from season one, no way this happens.
Uh-uh.
But the Agent Callus from season two, they turned into much more of an honorable type person. And I think if nothing else, he recognizes that Sabine and Wedge were not interested in the slaughter of the innocent, which they demonstrated in their simulation, and he can respect that.
Mm-hmm. Yep, definitely. Good point.
Yeah. So the escape goes much better this time, even though they nearly get shot down by the TIE Interceptor, and they're in a bomber. I didn't realize that both sections of the bomber could support people, or that the cockpit was that large.
Didn't either. Yeah, because you always think about even like just a TIE fighter and how cramped it is. But the TIE bomber is definitely a lot more roomy.
Yeah, I thought the other pod was just always full of ordnance. But no, that's where Wedge and Hobby were hanging out. But then before they can get shot down, Kanan and Ezra fly in to the rescue and get them out of there. So it's a tidy episode. It really is. I like it. It's neat to get Wedge's backstory. Like I said, it was fun to kind of get away from the serious is not the right word, but the dourness of some of the stuff that was going on with Kanan and Ezra in the previous couple episodes and focus on something that's just a bit more of an adventure, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because we've had a lot of really deep force lore and, you know, Jedi versus Sith kind of things and all of these different themes like forgiveness and trust and whatnot. And this was just straight in, just kind of going in with guns a-blazing and undercover work and get these people out of here. And then there's still a little bit of, you know, intrigue and interesting little dangles there for us to hang on to for the future too.
Yeah. Yeah. That infiltration angle was something they hadn't done for a while. So that was good. I like it a lot. And it's, I mean, don't get me wrong, I do like the Force aspects of the show, and there's plenty of those. There's plenty more to come, but it is nice to break things up a bit. You know, Ezra still got to be a little bit overbearing in how much he wanted to protect his friends, and, you know, Kanan had to keep tamping him down. You know, it's, you know, we gotta let her do her thing. And the episode guide pointed out how the roles had evolved when Ezra had gone undercover and infiltrated the academy on Lothal. It was Kanan who was all antsy about, you know, oh, I can't believe we put him in there, we got to go get him and get him out, and that type of thing. And now Kanan is counseling Ezra in this exact same position. You know, Ezra is like, she might be in trouble, we got to go get her and hang in there, we can't abandon her. And Kanan's like, stay calm, she can do this, she's got this. And then, we're no good to her dead, we'll come back and we'll get her, we're not abandoning her, type of thing. So yeah, there was some evolution of the characters in that regard.
Absolutely. Yeah. And you, like you said, it's a nice, tidy episode too. And it was just really enjoyable overall.
Indeed. Indeed. All right then. Well then, that'll bring us to the end of this episode. I'd like to thank you all for listening to another episode of Podcast Stardust and our discussion of the Antilles extraction. And we hope you've enjoyed this episode. And if you did, please make sure to subscribe to the Podcast Stardust. Please subscribe to Podcast Stardust on your podcatcher of choice. Also, we are part of the RetroZap.com podcast network, and all episodes of the podcast can be found on RetroZap.com. RetroZap is also home to several other great podcasts covering everything from the MCU and DC to Dune and Star Trek. As always, we would greatly appreciate a 5-star rating and review over on Apple Podcasts or whatever podcatcher you may be listening to us on. Make sure to share the show on social media as well. Speaking of which, Jay, where can they find us around the internet?
Very easy to find us. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And you can always check out our Pinterest boards. It has all kinds of fun things for Star Wars on that one. And our YouTube channel with all of our shows and our unboxing videos. And why not join us for some Discord chatter over on our Discord room on the RetroZap Discord server. That's a lot of Discords. Very easy to do to find us as well. Just go to our show page and click on the community tab and it'll take you right to where you need to go. And there's also a lot of other rooms that are dedicated to some fun things. And that's everything from Marvel to Dune and everything between. So you just have to check it out. And then we are also on TeePublic. We have 7 different show logo designs over there on t-shirts, sweatshirts, coffee mugs, home goods, apparel of every kind. And it's teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And they're always having some really great sales over there. So you have to check that one out. And then as far as that goes, that's it for us. But what about your personal projects that you've got going on right now? I know you've got some warp trails going on with your wife over there, Dennis. So why don't you tell us about that?
Yep. Beth and I are eagerly awaiting the debut of season 4 of Star Trek Discovery. And once that is here, we'll be firing things up and getting back into recording our reviews of Star Trek. And in the meantime, head over to the RetroZap podcast feed where you can find warp trails and check out our back episodes covering the first 3 seasons of Discovery. And there's a lot to remember, a lot to get back into. It's kind of fun to go back and look at those and see how the show's evolved and defied our expectations over the past couple of years. And with that, what can you tell us about your world of cosplay?
Oh, yeah, definitely. And I always, every time I see those Discovery commercials, I always think of you guys. So you're always you're always on my mind. Over on J.Snips Cosplay on Instagram, you can catch me mostly as Ahsoka and also some other things as well. So you never know what you're going to find over there. And I just really am having a lot of fun interacting with people over there. And just also supporting other cosplayers as well. And it's just been a really great community and a lot of talent over there. So if you'd like to check out a variety of different types of cosplayers, not just Star Wars, there's a heck of a lot of fun going on. And again, that is at j.snipscosplay.
All right, then. That'll do it for episode 342 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.